And hello, everyone. Thanks so much for joining me. I can't see everybody that's here. Rob, Diane, Pam, is it Rana or Rona? Sorry. Dan was there before I know. Veronica, Rhonda. We got people from all over the place. The States, the Netherlands, Australia. Carol, hi. Who else is with me that I haven't mentioned? Veronica, did I say Veronica? Maybe not. And Pam, the other Pam, yeah. All right. Hopefully I got all you guys. So thanks so much for joining me. So let's jump into it today. If you are not familiar with me, I'm Kim Jameson Hurst of Chatterbox Quilts, and my company is, the goal of my company, I should say, is to provide you with solutions to the obstacles that are preventing you from being the best quilter you can be, to reaching your full quilting potential. So I do that through courses, and you can see some of those at learn.chatterboxquilts.com, and more are coming, and also through Chatterbox Quilts Live, which you're watching now. This is on every second and fourth Thursday of the month at 1 o'clock Mountain Standard Time. And I also have a YouTube channel, so if you want to pop over there and see what I've got to help you, certainly do that. You can find me by looking up Chatterbox Quilts or Chatterbox Quilter even, and on YouTube. So, oh, you're very welcome. Is it Rana? Am I saying Rana or Rona? You'll have to let me know. Is it on or own? Rana, thank you. She's saying thank you for all the videos. You're welcome. I have fun filming them. As a matter of fact, I just wrapped up filming, four or five videos on the weekend. Sort of unexpectedly, we filmed about five or six, I think, this past week. Unexpectedly, because it's to do with an upgrade on my Janome 9400. If you don't know, I'm a Janome artisan for Janome Canada, and as part of that collaboration, I have on loan a Janome 9400 from them, which I've been really enjoying using. And it's got all kinds of great features, but the one thing you couldn't do is you couldn't use rulers on it. It didn't have a ruler foot, let's put it that way. So it didn't natively give you the ability to use a ruler foot on it and do ruler work. You could get around it by using other manufacturers' feet, but the software in the machine was not set up to accept that, and you had to be very careful that you didn't damage the machine. So for those of us who are waiting patiently, the ruler foot along with three other feet have now come out, and I'm going to talk about those a little more later on because people were asking me about it. But films are done. Films are edited, films are coming up on YouTube. So the next few weeks on Tuesdays is when you see my YouTube videos being released. You're gonna see more on the 9400. So if you don't own a 9400, my apologies, it's gonna be 9400 month. But if you do, you're gonna wanna watch these and see what these, you know, what's happened with the machine and what these feet can do, because I know some people are wanting to know about it and wanting to decide if they want it for themselves or not. So Rana, yes, thank you. And you've got a Janome 9400. Oh, yes, and she has to wait 6 weeks, 6 weeks to get it. Oh, dear, that's a long time, isn't it? But anyway, it will come eventually, and then you'll be, by that time you'll have watched all my videos, you'll know what to do with these new feet that come in. All right, so let's get to some of the questions that we had, because you have questions and I have answers. And if you have, sorry, I'm probably talking fast today, I need to slow down a bit. If you have any other suggestions than what I mentioned, please put them in the comments as these questions come up, because I don't know everything, and sometimes other people have other solutions that I haven't heard of too, so I like to learn as well. And that's what we do in my Facebook group. If you are not in my Facebook group, I think most of you are watching probably are, but if you aren't, you want to join that group. It's called Chatterbox Quilts, and it's on Facebook, so you can check for Chatterbox Quilts group on Facebook and join us there. So let's take a look at the first question, and it just happens to be a sewing machine question. So this is from Vicky. She's in Syracuse, New York. She's got an Elna 780, and that's a cousin to the Janome 9400. So she's had it for about a month, and she is having trouble with her top thread shredding. That's hard to say. Try and say that three times in a row. And that's when she's trying to free motion quilt. So the thread is shredding all the time, and she has to stop and break thread and start again. So she's wondering what kind of thread or needles I recommend to avoid that issue. She has looked online, and most of the solutions say change the needle, but she'd be doing that all the time if that was the case, because it happens all the time to her. So she's using Aurifil 50 weight in the top and the bobbin, so she's matching her thread weights. And she's wondering if there's a thread that these machines like better, or should you use the Janome purple tip needles to quilt? Okay, so there can be a lot of different reasons why your thread is shredding. Now, anything from you're using a poor quality thread, which you're not in this case, because Aurifil is a good thread for sure, to you could be there's a problem with the specific needle that you're using. Maybe it has a burr, some little catch in the eye of it or along the needle, and that's causing your thread to shred. But if you change your needle and it's still happening, that's not the problem. Could be the size of the needle, though. You could be using a needle where the eye isn't big enough for the thread to pass through easily. So that is something I would consider, trying a different size needle. And having said that, when I'm free motion quilting on my Janome, I do use the purple tip needles because they are the ones that work the best. Okay, and as I'm talking, you guys, I'm realizing which camera are you guys looking at? You're seeing that camera, right? Yeah. I'm so confused as to what's working today and what's not. Hopefully I'm not looking off the side at you, but I think I'm looking at you guys. So I would go to those purple tip needles. I know it might be a pain for you to get them. You can order them online too. If you're too far away from a store to get them, you can order them online. The other thing I would suggest that you use is the blue tip bobbin case that you can get. That's an optional bobbin case or bobbin holder, they call it. And it is one that has a looser tension on it, so it works really well for free motion quilting. So I always have the purple tip needles in, and I always have the blue tip or blue dot bobbin case in as well. So hopefully you can get that bobbin case or bobbin holder for your Elna. I would check with your dealer if the Janome one doesn't work with it, they probably have a similar one for Elna. That combination usually works. I haven't had any issues on my machine, so I would give it a try. The other thing is, sometimes I've noticed this with my machine is when I put the needle in to make sure it's pushed all the way up. Sometimes it's almost there, but not quite. So you got to make sure that you unscrew the needle little screw that holds the needle in. So technical, aren't I? And push that needle all the way up, and then tighten the screw up as well, because that could be an issue. It could be down just a little bit, and it's not quite seated properly. So that's also something to think about. All right. I am looking at the right camera. Thank you for letting me know that, Pam. Hi, Jessica. Thanks for joining us. Everybody say hi to Jessica. Jessica is one of my business buddies, and Jessica's expecting a baby anytime now. So exciting. All right. Oh, and Rana is telling me that, okay, there is an Oregon. Oh yeah, Oregon needles are good as well. There's a Super Stretch HA. Well, you guys can see in the comments there, a 1490, identical to purple needle. Yes, yeah, Super Stretch, not just Stretch. Well, that's interesting. So you got Stretch and Super Stretch. Okay. And yes, they do have the cobra head described by Oregon, a snake head. Oh yes, okay. So that's another needle that you could try as well. But I'm suspecting it's some combination here that's not working quite right. And I'm almost wondering if you're using a needle where the eye is just not quite big enough. Maybe just not the right kind of needle for that particular machine. It's not liking it as well for some reason or other. But give those a try, Vicky, and let me know how that works. If you're still having problems, not let me know. Okay, let's see here. What else? Ah, this is a really good question. This comes in from Jean. She is considering upgrading her travel sewing machine. So she presently owns a Janome Platinum Gem, and it's a wonderful little sewing machine for its size. It sews beautifully. However, it's very basic, and she misses the needle up down and the scissors function, which is your thread cutter function. You get so used to these features when you have them on the machine, don't you? And then when they're not there, you're like, ah, how did I sew before? She wants to get a slightly bigger machine with a few more features and stitches. That would be ideal for quilting away from home. Do you have any suggestions? And she says, thanks. I love Chatterbox Quilts and the great information and videos provided on your site. Thank you very much, Jean. I appreciate that. Now, Jean, where to start? Oh my goodness. So, a few things. First off, I would usually look when I'm looking at any kind of sewing machine, you want to look and see what features do you want. So if you want the needle up down, you want the thread cutter, maybe there's some other ones you want. Do you want decorative stitches? Like if you're using it for quilting, do you really want decorative stitches on it? Or do you just want a machine that is a good setup for free motion quilting and for piecing? So I'm not exactly sure there. You said you want some more stitches on it, so maybe you do want some decorative stitches, but there are machines that are great straight stitch machines. I used to have one. A Juki TL2010Q is one of them. Brother has a similar machine out. They're both pretty much identical, really. PQ1500SL or Janome has a 1600P-QC, and all of those are straight stitch machines, but they straight sew a really good straight stitch. So depending on what you're looking for, those are some options. The other thing I would consider is your budget, because if you have a little machine that was $200 or $300 or $500, these machines are going to be more money. And as you go up into more features, the price gets a little higher as well. And sometimes for the features you want, you get a whole bunch of other ones thrown in. It's like buying a car, right? You just want this, but you get 50 other things coming at the same time, and those things will add to the price of the machine, of course. The other thing is, if you're looking for something to go, like I'm not sure if you're in an RV or you're just talking about traveling and you're staying in hotels, or whether you have a cabin you go to, whatever, consider your space. So if you're limited for space, if you're in an RV, you're limited for space, right? So if you're limited for space, then that is something you need to factor in when you're looking at the machine too, because if you get something like my Janome 9400 here, which is a big machine, it may not fit in your space, especially if you've gone from a little gem to a bigger machine. You might not really think about that. I don't think a lot of people think about that. But if you have a specific cabinet or a table you want to use it in, measure that cutout area to make sure the machine's going to fit in as well. The other thing is, if you are looking for something with some decorative stitches and also the needle up and the thread cutter, Janome has a line called Skyline that's quite new. And there's a Skyline S3, and that has those features in it and some decorative stitches as well. So that might be one to take a look at it. So figure out the features you want, figure out your budget, keep in mind where you're going to be using it if you're limited space-wise. And then I would start, you could do some research online to kind of narrow it down a bit, but you really need to go and sew at a dealer to see what the machine is like, because, you know, some people get really used to a certain brand. So if you already have a Janome, you go to another Janome, the features are similar, the places where things are on it is similar, so it feels comfortable. That can be kind of nice too. So you'll notice, you know, between the different brands there can be differences, and sometimes that's, you know, a little uncomfortable for people, and they kind of just want to have the same kind of machine. So those are just a few suggestions I have for you. But I would, you know, you've got to figure out what exactly you want first and how much you're willing to pay for it before you start looking. And keep in mind that there may be, if you're not in a real hurry to get anything, look for sales, right? There are sales on at different times. There's some spring sales going on right now with Janome, I know. So keep that in mind too. All right. Now, who is this that has all these questions? I know who it is this camera. Diane, and Diane's watching me, I know. So Diane, you asked a whole bunch of questions. So let's see here. You wanted, at least I think it's Diane here. I got different pages going here, so make sure. Yes. Yes, yes, yes. So she wants a refresher on how to square up quilt blocks. Don't we all? That's something we all get to use every so often. It's a good one. She's asking, do you square up as you make them or when they're all done? Well, two thoughts here, I guess, really. But my thought is, if they're all going into one quilt, which I assume they are, I would wait until they're done. And the reason I would wait until they're done is I would see what is your smallest block, because then you're going to trim all the other ones up to that size, right? Because the goal is to have all the blocks in the quilt be the same size. So if you start trimming as you go along, you get to the end, you still may have a whole bunch of blocks or all different sizes. So I would wait until you get them all done. Now, having said that, before you get to that stage, I would maybe be checking a quarter inch seam allowance first, right? So that's probably the most important thing. If you're getting an accurate quarter inch seam allowance, theoretically, all the blocks will be the same size or pretty close. So that may be a preventative measure, so you don't have to go and square a whole bunch of blocks up. All right. How perfect do they have to be? I love this. This is like me. I'm always going, oh yeah, well, I can stretch that or I can squeeze that into fit. Okay, how perfect do they have to be? How much can a block be off and still work in a quilt? Well, because we work with quarter inch seams, anything that's greater than a quarter inch difference between them, you're going to have some real problems, I think. If they're, you know, around an eighth of an inch or something like that, under a quarter for sure, you can probably, like I said, kind of fit them in. Some you can stretch a little bit and some you can ease in a little bit and you'll be okay. I'm sure we've all done that. But if it's anything more than a quarter inch difference between them, you're definitely going to want to trim them. And, you know, sometimes, like I said, when I've got, like if I'm putting two blocks together and one is sitting like this a little higher than the other one, you know, you can kind of ease it in a little bit. You stretch the other one just a tad and you can do that. But I would say less than a quarter of an inch. Anything more than that, you're going to have some real problems, I think. All right, that's just my opinion. You guys, if you got other opinions, please jump in on that one. That's a good question, for sure. Here's another interesting question. I had to do some research on this one, actually, because I'm not familiar with what she's talking about. She's asking about the Janome 9400, which I'm familiar with, and that's a high shank machine. Okay, she's ordered her upgrade ruler foot package. That's the upgrade I was talking about, because it comes with the ruler foot in it. But she also has a Westerly ruler made for a low shank machine. Can I use them on the 9400? So Westerly, if you're not familiar with it, and I'm sure my viewers in Australia know what we're talking about here, they come with different feet, like ruler feet, and they also come with templates or what we call rulers that you can use on the machines with the ruler foot. So they make ruler feet for high shank machines, low shank machines. I think they call them mid shank, and there's something else. Special shank, I think they call it. I didn't really look into that one because I'm not sure about that. But there's a difference in their rulers too. So they have high shank and low shank rulers, which I thought was kind of odd at first till I read a little bit more about it. So you should be able to use the low shank rulers on your high shank machine, but you couldn't use high shank rulers on a low shank machine. And I should have something to show you here why that is, because it didn't make sense. Just a sec, guys. I just want to grab a pencil here if I can find something. Pencil, pen, something to show you this. How about a marker here? Okay, this will work. So if you have your the shank. So that's the part that your foot attaches to, right? It's got the hole in, you have that, you screw it in, right? So that's your shank. So on a low shank machine, the shank comes down close to the bottom, like the needle plate, okay? On a high shank machine, it's higher, right? So they have different heights on their rulers. So if you have a low shank template, so it's going to be low, you know, not that thick, and you have a high shank machine, that's going to work okay. But if you have the high shank ruler and the low shank, you know, machine, then it could hit. It probably will hit. Now, having said that, where's it hit? It hits at the back. It's at the back of the foot is what they're talking about having an issue with. So you could use the ruler at the side of your ruler foot. You could use it at the front of the ruler foot. But if you put it around the back, that shank is going to come down and it's going to hit it. Okay, because at the front of the foot, you've got your ruler foot, right? You've got your ruler and you've got your shank is coming here. This is the back of the machine. This is you looking at the machine. Okay, so you don't have any problems putting your rulers around here, right? But when it comes to the back, that shank is coming down and it's going to hit that template probably. So that's why. Okay, so I learned something new because I'm not that familiar with Wesley. I don't use them. I've certainly seen them around. They're very popular. They have a lot of different templates or rulers, I would call them. So yes, you could probably do that. And having said that, I would check it out and see because it's easy enough to check out, right? Put your ruler foot on your machine, put your, you know, your foot down, see if that template will fit behind the foot. And if it doesn't fit behind the foot, you have a few choices. You could use it at the side or at the front of the foot and just don't ever put it at the back, or you could buy the right templates for that ruler foot. So up to you, whichever you want to do. We often do not use rulers at the back of the foot. It's kind of awkward anyway, but some people do. It depends on the place that you're at in your quilt. So but that was interesting. Angel, welcome. Yes, you're with us live today. Great. Angel has trouble catching us live, so I'm glad you managed to do that today. Welcome. All right, so another question, also from Diane. How to sew a scant quarter-inch seam on the 9400? So we're getting into the Janome 9400 technical specs here. Can I move the position of the needle? Well, you can. On the Janome 9400, you have lots of choices for sewing a quarter-inch seam. My favorite combination is using the HP industrial foot and needle plate. So that is a specific quarter-inch little foot. It works really well. And that gives you basically a scant quarter, really. You can't really move the needle on that one because it's a straight stitch only with a straight stitch type of needle plate. So you're not going to be able to move your needle. However, there is an O-foot as well. And when you get the upgrade kit, there's an O-foot without a guide down the side. So that one, you can certainly move your needle position over if you want to. You can adjust it. So that would work really easily. All right. Rana says she loves the HP foot. Oh, yes. Yes, yes, yes. And Diane too. Yes. So what else? How to successfully sew over a thick seam? Oh, that's a tough one. I think that is, you're asking about sewing over zipper feet, I think, maybe. Diane, somebody else was if it wasn't you. So, you know, I think the machines, I hate to say this, I sound like I'm old, right? I hate the machines nowadays, right? I think that's a difficult thing for a lot of machines to do if you're going right through the zipper feet. Zipper foot? Zipper feet? Zipper teeth. That's what I'm trying to say. Zipper teeth. Okay, so if you're trying to go through that because they're metal and everything, right? You know, you're not going to be able to whip right through them. You're going to break a needle or something, I'm guessing. I don't sew with zippers, really. Zippers kind of scare me a bit. I mean, they're not that hard to do, I know, but I don't really get into them that much, so I can't speak from personal experience. But what I would suggest you do is to go through, either really sew with your machine, or even better, if you're going right through the zipper teeth, is to do it manually. Use your hand wheel towards you, and go along very slowly, and that needle will go down. It'll probably go in between the teeth. If it's hitting something, you can just move the zipper, move your fabric, whatever you're sewing, a little bit, and it'll probably slide in between those teeth and go through. If you're just talking about thick seams, again, you're going to have to go through slowly. I think most of us, if you've gone through thick seams, the machine starts taking a really short stitch. You have to slow right down. You may have to do it manually with the hand wheel. You may have to, if you're sewing along and the whole project is like that, make sure you're sewing with a heavier needle, a thicker needle, of course, to make it easier too. But I think, you know, if you're talking about going over zipper teeth, that's a tough one. And I think it's something you do manually with the machine. If anybody has any other tips on that one, if you encounter those problems and you've been able to get over them, surely let me know because I would like to know here. Okay, Pam is saying that if you're making bags, Sewing the straps on requires a thick seam. Yeah, there's a special foot with a button you push that lets it kind of rock over the seam. So same kind of thing, it's just kind of going a little bit over them. So yeah, so that's something to look at. There probably are some other feet too that would work a little bit better perhaps too. So not an expert on that one. So again, if anybody else has any other suggestions besides Pam, please post them there. And thank you, Pam, for that tip as well. Speaking of Pam, Pam is one of the questions I'm coming to right next. That's funny, isn't it? So she wants to know, okay, she wants to know how I started Chatterbox Quilts, how I came up with that name and stuff. We're going to talk about me later. Let's get through all your questions first. She has the 9400 and the ruler foot. She'd like to know what else is in the kit, how I like it. I'm not a school teacher, Pam. She thinks I might be a school teacher. I'm not a school teacher. I'm an admin assistant in the office. But I might as well be some days, I think. No, that's not true. But I get to see all the kids. So it's like being sort of a teacher, part of a teacher for all the kids in the school. So I get to see a lot of them. But not a teacher, but I do love teaching. Hence why I do things like this. And yes, it's a fun job for sure. Okay, so Pam, I'm going to get to you and Patty as well, because both of you are asking about the 9400. Patty wants to know if I have info about the Janome 9400 update. What does it do? Is it worth the money? All that stuff. So, as I said, I've just finished wrapping up some filming, and it's all about the 9400 upgrade, all about what's in the kit. So what's in the kit? I was going to say, where's my little thing here? I can show you my little guy here. There's a USB that comes in the kit. That's going to update the software on your machine. That's what's going to let you work with the ruler foot, and there's some other things as well that it does. It changes some information on the display screen. It doesn't change the settings or things like that, but it works with the new feet. So you have 4 feet coming in the upgrade kit, the long-awaited, much-anticipated ruler foot, the QR foot. There is a variable zigzag foot, which is an open-toe foot, and that is the QZ foot. And then there is, let me see if I can remember this. I've been working with them so much I've forgotten. there's an O foot. So that's your quarter-inch foot without the guide, and it has some additional markings on it that the previous foot didn't have, which you're going to love. And, oh yes, the open-toe PDH foot. So that's your open-toe darning foot or free-motion quilting foot. So I love the fact that these are open-toes. You can see the visibility is so much better with these. So you're going to see videos on those and how they work. But the big thing, of course, is the ruler foot. So now the ruler foot's really nice. It has a cutout in the front. So again, better visibility. It's not cut right through, but that little U shape in the front. And you can see a lot easier. And it's nice and thick. And yeah, it's really nice. I love it. It goes on and you can just start quilting with, ruler work, no problem. So that's where you're going to see some changes on the screen for the ruler work. For the variable zigzag is slightly changed, I believe. PDH foot's the same. And the variable zigzag is the same. So whether it's worth it or not, I don't know. It depends on what you do on your machine. So, my thoughts are kind of yes, because if you've been wanting to do ruler work, when you think about it, you get 4 feet in there. And I don't know how much it costs. It depends on your country. I'm saying around $100 probably, a little over $100, a little under, depending on where you are. For 4 feet, for $100 plus an upgrade to the machine, that doesn't seem too bad to me. It just depends. If you are not interested in doing ruler work, if you're not interested in an open toe free motion foot, or you're not doing variable zigzag, if you're not doing those techniques, maybe you don't want it. But if you want to do some of those things, yes, I would get it. There I said it. Go buy it. No. And Rana said she couldn't believe the clear foot and ruler foot didn't come with this machine. Yes, I agree. I was surprised as well, because I have a Janome 8900 and the ruler, there's a ruler foot. I had to buy it for it, but it had the capacity of doing ruler work. This one has an automatic pressure foot lifter, and that was what's causing the issue, that it would come up and whack into the assembly with the ruler foot and things like that. So that was the issue there. But it was a little disappointing for people. I think if you had been used to doing ruler work on your machine and you got this one, and while you could get around it using Westerly ruler feet or other ones, if you damaged your machine, avoided your warranty. So a lot of people didn't want to do that, of course. So yes, and I'm glad that it is finally out, because we've been waiting for it for quite some time. So again, see what techniques you want to do. If you want to do those techniques, get the kit. It looks nice. It comes in a very nice box. All right, so that's what it looks like. So yeah, I like the open toe feet. I really like that. I like being able to see, and it's a really nice ruler foot for it. Good, heavy, and I like that U shape in the front. Not all of them have that. So yes. Okay, let's see here. What else we're saying here? What thread? This is Pat asking me. What thread would you prefer for free motion quilting with a ruler foot? If your choices are Aurifil, King Tut, Omni, or Glide, do you like to use 40 or 50 weight? Okay, so there's a lot of choices there, right? There's a lot of thread out there, and I use different kinds of thread depending on what I'm doing. I don't use a certain thread because I'm doing ruler work. I use a certain thread because of the design I want to create. So if I am creating great big open spaces, I just did a quilt with great big swirls on it, and I used a King Tut on it because King Tut is 30 or 35, I always forget, but it's not a 50 or 60 weight. So it's a heavier thread and you're going to see the quilting and you're going to see the color on the quilt. So it's more a choice of, do you want to see the design or do you want to see just texture? How intricate is your design? So if it's a very small, you know, if you're doing little tiny pebbles or something, you certainly don't want to lay down a 30 weight thread because it'll just be all closed in, right? So I've used everything from, you know, a 30 weight up to an 80 weight, I guess, some 100 weight, but that's usually on my long arm. So it just depends on what I'm doing. So think about whether you want to see the thread or not, how big is your design, and that's how I choose my thread from there. Good thread you're talking about there, I'm not familiar with, I haven't used Omni. Glide I've used in the top and the bottom, actually. Yeah, and I like Glide a lot too. Aurifil's great. And it depends what kind of look you want as far as, you know, some are a little bit shiny, some are not shiny, some are flat. So that depends too on the look you want to get. So my suggestion is lay down thread and see what it looks like on your quilt. And again, if it's a smaller design, you go thinner. So the more intricate and smaller the design is, the thinner the weight of the thread you go. That's my suggestion. Anybody else have other suggestions for that? Let me know. And other threads that you might consider as well. Silk is nice too, but expensive to use as well. So there's other superior threads I like too. I love King Tut for the color, but sometimes it's a little thicker than what I like to use now, but I love the variegated colors in it. It's very pretty. Okay, Susan. Susan wants to know if there's a good site to buy fabric in Canada. What a great question. Lots of US ones, but with the delivery charge, the difference in the dollar, it's hard to find anything online. Yes, because when you're in another country, you're like, we're in Canada and our dollar isn't the same as the US, and then we end up paying shipping charges, which, you know, most people have to pay some kind of shipping charge, but sometimes you even get dinged with duty coming across the border as well. So it can end up being quite a bit of money. So having said that, if you're looking at a US site, be careful and be clear on what they're covering for and what they're not. So some people will cover your brokerage fees and stuff. So you don't get charged duty. They will include that in their shipping price, but a lot of them don't. So again, it's going to cost you more money than you may realize to get things sometimes. Talking about good sites in Canada, there are quite a few of them. One of my favorites is Hamel's. Hamel's Fabrics in Chilliwack, BC. Hamel's has a lot of pre-cuts. They carry a lot of pre-cuts. If you aren't fortunate enough to see them at a quilt show, I see them in Alberta all the time. So they have all kinds of pre-cuts. They have kits. They have fabric yardage. You know, fat quarters, they have everything. They carry a lot of things. They've been around for a long time. So I like Hamel's. A threaded needle, one of my personal favorites. If you like Japanese topes and Japanese like cotton fabrics, a threaded needle has great fabrics. They're out of BC as well. And they also, if you're into bag making, they have all the accessories, the handles, the hardware and everything for bags. So totally different stock than what Hamel's carries. They're online too. And who was the other one I was thinking? Oh yes, Sew Sisters in Toronto is a good one, as is Flair Fabrics. That's another one. They have more modern fabrics. But any of these are good Canadian retailers online that have been around for a while. So any of those I could recommend. Hamel's Fabrics, A Threaded Needle, Sew Sisters, or Flair Fabrics. Again, if anybody else has other ones they like to use, let me know. This is going off the top of my head thinking, who are the ones I usually look at and who are the ones I buy from? So if you have other ones, let us know. Okay, so then let me get into a lot of questions about, let's see here. No, we're not going to go there. We're going to go into just a second here. Another Pam had a question speaking about thread, we're back to thread again. What do I do when I have a little bit of thread on my bobbins? Huh, that's a good question, isn't it? Every time I sew, my machine warns me my bobbin is about to run out, which is great. And I don't want that to happen in the middle of line of stitching or quilting, but I then have many bobbins with just a little bit of thread left on them. Do I ever wind more over what's left? Oh, I used to do that when I would sew. I don't when I'm quilting. Or do you just pull it off and toss it? I'm collecting lots of partially filled bobbins that are not available for new projects. So let's see. Well, it depends on what kind of thread it is and how much is left on it. So I try and get it down as low as possible. Having said that, when I'm piecing, I usually have the same thread on my bobbin, not switching different colors or things like that. But if it's rayon or polyester or something like that, I'll take it off and pitch it. I'll be honest, I don't keep it. If it's a cotton, I may take it off and keep it in. I have a little tin for hand sewing, so I can use it to sew the bindings. When I hand sew my bindings, I can use that thread, right? I usually use cotton for that, so that will work really well. When it comes to my long arm, that's always very deceptive as to how much thread is actually left on the bobbin because they're bigger bobbins. So some of those I will keep, and I just keep them with the thread because, like the thread cone, so I can use them next time. And I would do that with colored ones too, like when I have rayons and stuff I'm using for machine embroidery or when I'm using them for finishing the edges on my appliques. I would keep those too with the cone. But I do unwind and throw out a lot because otherwise you have all these partially wound bobbins. And I always say you can never have too many bobbins because, like, you know, I think if I have 20 of them, that's still not enough. One thing you can do is if you're an art quilter, you can keep those little bits of thread because you can lay those down and put tulle or net over top and stitch them down so they make nice embellishments. And some people may put them, again, if it's cotton, I don't think the other kinds, but if they're cotton, you could put them outside and the birds may take them to build nests in the springtime. People will do that with their fabric scraps too if they're very small. All right, so that's my idea on that. So I do unwind a lot of them. And it's funny you should say that. Do you put other thread over top? Because when I buy my vintage machines and they come with the bobbins, so many of them have several different colors of, several different types, I should say, of thread wound on those bobbins. That was something you used to do, I think, when you're sewing and stuff a lot of times. So that's kind of funny. We don't do that with quilting as much, I don't think. But yes. There was another question. I know Rob is watching, and Rob is asking about the AccuQuilt Go system. We're going to talk about that either in another live or probably in our group, in our Chatterbox Quilts Facebook group, because that's a whole other topic, and there's lots of different tips to tell you about with that particular one. If you've got an AccuQuilt Go, come into the group, and we're going to talk about that coming up soon, because that's a really great machine to use. I have it and a few other die cutter machines as well. But I can certainly speak to that machine, but there's a lot of things to tell you about it and suggestions for what type of dies I would get starting off, because they have an awful lot of dies. You can spend a lot of money on buying dies, that's for sure. Okay, so then another question I had, that's most of the technical kind of questions that I had, but we also had questions about me. I don't talk a lot about me all the time, but I forget now if this is Susan asking, I think, about how many UFO projects do you have? I know Rob is laughing his head off right now. I can just tell. When did I start sewing? When did I start quilting? Then who was it? Was it Pam that asked me? No. Pam asked me how I started Chatterbox Quilts, how I came up with the name and things like that. Here comes Tika. She's going to speak to all these questions now. Because she was around. We started all this stuff, weren't you, Tika? Yes, you were. So let me tell you a little bit about myself. Okay, so she says it's neat to know more about you. It makes us feel like we're quilting buddies. Of course, we're all quilting buddies. Yes, we are. And let me tell you a little bit. Okay, so let's start with my family. So I'm married. I've been married for a lot of years. I've been married for 30, how many years is it now? Oh my gosh, I have to think. It'll be 34 years. Yeah, it'll be 34 years this year, actually. And so I have a son who's 18, and he is in post-secondary education. I have a daughter who's 21. Also in post-secondary education, and I've got my husband. You hear me talk about my husband sometimes, Gary, who films all my YouTube videos and helps me with my business, my marketing and everything. He's the one who keeps me going all the time. When I'm not motivated and inspired, he will certainly inspire me while he'll make me work. He's much more focused. He's an engineer, so he's much more focused than I am. And so we've been doing this for quite a while. I guess we've been doing YouTube videos for probably about 7 years, 7, 8 years, something like that. And I guess I started off quilting when I was an adult. I didn't quilt when I was a child. I didn't even sew when I was a child. My mom did, but she didn't really have the patience to teach me because I asked so many questions. And so I didn't start sewing until I was about 25 or 26, and I moved out to Calgary. I'm originally from Ontario, from Chatham, Ontario. Any of you back east there that may be watching. But I came out here, I was transferred out here with the business I worked for at the time, and I stayed. So I started sewing. I didn't really like sewing too much because, you know, you have to make things fit and nothing ever fits properly. Did that when my kids were younger because things don't have to fit them very well. But then I got into quilting through a friend of mine, and I just kind of went in, as I tend to do with a lot of things, full, both feet, full force into there. So what happened after that is that very soon I started wanting to change patterns. I didn't want to do them exactly the same way they were. So then I thought, well, I might as well design patterns because I have all these ideas. So I did that. I still have a line of patterns out under Chatterbox Quilts, and you can see those on my website. I have a Craftsy store as well. But I don't really design patterns anymore because I'm too busy talking to you guys and filming YouTube videos. That's where my passion really lies. So I guess I started Chatterbox Quilts in about 2008, and that was when I started designing the patterns. And those were quilting patterns, hand embroidery patterns. I had some little stuffy patterns as well. And you wonder how I came up with Chatterbox Quilts? Well, I told you I'm from Chatham, Ontario, and I like to talk. If you know me, you know I love to talk. And my son actually says, "Mom, you're a chatterbox from Chatham," and the name stuck. So Chatterbox Quilts it was, and I guess it's appropriate. My friends tell me it's very appropriate. It's memorable anyway. So I was going to say I started with designing patterns. Now I've gone to designing online courses, and as I mentioned, I have some that are available on my learn.chatterboxquilts.com. And I'm also a Janome artisan. And I work for Janome. I don't work for them. In that they pay me with letting me use their machines. So right now I have the Janome 9400, and I'm loving using it. So I do blogs for them as well, and I'm also a columnist at Quilters Connection magazine. We just started that about 6 months ago, I guess. So that's a quarterly publication. You've heard me talk about it before, perhaps. It's a Canadian quilting magazine. You can get it at Chapters in Canada. So I write a column for them, and I base that on not techniques. Because what I'm really moving into even more is talking about helping you with things that are bothering you. So it may be that you're frustrated with you never find time for quilting. Maybe it's that you have too many UFOs. Maybe you're feeling overwhelmed in your studio because you have too many things. I wonder what that feels like. I get there all the time. So, you know, there are these little things that stop you from being the best quilter, or I say reaching your quilting potential. So those are the things I want to address. Those are the things I'm going to be offering in courses coming up. These are the things we were talking about in our group different times as well. So that's sort of what I'm doing, because there's lots of courses out there on techniques, but there aren't many courses that address some of the other problems that I hear many, many quilters talk about. So those are the things I want to be able to help you with, because I know I have those same issues and I have overcome most of them, and sometimes they creep back up on me again. But you know, I found a way of working around those. So, and when you ask me how many UFOs I have, I'm going to probably tell you too many. Okay, too many. I couldn't begin to count, to be quite honest with you, because some of them are things I start as a sample for a course, perhaps. So they are just going to sit there as a sample. They're not going to get finished. I've done several quilt alongs. Those are still waiting to be quilted. The tops are done, but they're still need to be quilted because they're more complicated, and I want to make sure I know exactly what I want to do with them before I put them on the long arm. You know, there are ones I get easily distracted, so I will jump from one thing to the next. I'm trying very hard not to do that. I'm trying very hard to focus and still work on one project to get it finished, because even though logically I know if I don't stick to one project, it'll never get finished. Like nothing gets finished, right? If I jump from thing to thing to thing, nothing gets done. Nothing is ever a quilt. But you know, emotionally, or whatever you want to call that brain that takes over, I just want to go. I get bored. I get bored very easily. So I get bored and I want to go to something else. But then, you know, you look around and you go, gosh, there's no quilts because they're all in various stages of completion. So I'm focusing right now on quilting quilt tops and moving forward on those so I can get them done. And then, you know, check off the list it goes. So that's what I'm working on these days. And what else? Some things you might not know about me. Although I haven't done it for a while, I play the piano. I've taught piano for when I was younger to younger children. That was fun. See, I've always been teaching. I used to play the trumpet in high school. There's another thing you probably didn't know about me. I speak French, although I don't do it as often as I should. I have a degree in French language, actually, so working at the French immersion school is great for me. And I love to have chocolate in the studio. Probably most of you know that about me. Chocolate is a quilting essential in my studio. And there's some sitting right over there, actually. So that's sort of about me, I guess. If you have any other specific questions, you can always ask me. I may or may not answer. But that's kind of me. So like most of you, I love going to quilt shows. I love quilting with my buddies. I love the interaction that we share. Only if it's live, it's only every other week. But if you're in my Facebook group, we're talking every day. I like to do that. I like reading what you guys are up to. I like seeing what you're creating. There are some amazing quilters in my group. And I learn from all of you as well. So I thank you so much for watching me today. As I mentioned, maybe I mentioned when you couldn't hear me or see me before, there were some questions that came in later that I didn't get around to answering today because they came in too late for me to prepare for them. So I'll be looking at those and maybe we'll do those next time. Or again, they might be in my Facebook group. That's a good place to answer things as well. And if you are not getting free content from me, did you know you can get free content from me in your email inbox? That's hard to say, to email inbox. So you certainly can. So we send out helpful quilting information about every 2 weeks. So if you're not already getting that, you can sign up by going to www.chatterboxquilts.com/free-content. So I would highly recommend to do that. Lots of good things come out that way. And if you have any other questions, just put them in the comments below. And I just better answer Pam here. She's talking about behind me, this Klimt panel. Yes, this is the Kiss. Isn't that beautiful? When I was away on an offsite a couple weeks ago, I stopped at a quilt store outside of Calgary. See, I can't resist either. And they had this new line was just coming in. They were just cutting it. So let me just show you. You guys can see that, I am sure. It's too big to go on camera. Isn't that pretty? And they have these coordinates. I think you can see those now. They had different colors, but I like the gold and the blacks are pretty. So yeah, I know that's pretty, but I thought, there you go. There's another project in the making, right? But I haven't touched it yet, and I'm not going to touch it for a while. Pam has this painting of the wall in her living room. It's beautiful, isn't it? I love his work. Beautiful, beautiful. So yeah, but that one I could just throw, like I've got those ones there. I can put a couple little smaller border, bigger border, and it'd be done, right? Till I have to quilt it. But no, I'm not doing anything with that. And I'm not even going to show you the things I bought at the quilt show. I'm not showing you that. No, I'm not. Check out in the group. I'll probably put pictures. And I'll give you some pictures, too, about, I'll probably put them on my Facebook page, about some of the quilts at the show, too, so you can see what was there, because they were gorgeous. Lots of gorgeous quilts there. Unbelievable workmanship. Okay, so that's about it for me today, guys. Thank you so much for your patience today. I hope I answered your questions. Again, if you have any comments or suggestions on the questions that I answered today, please put them in the comments below, and thank you for those who've already done that. And if you have more questions, you can always post them on my Facebook group or send them to me at kim@chatterboxquilts.com. Okay, guys, I hope you have a great rest of your day. And now I'm going to go upstairs if I can get out of the house or if I have to shovel. Okay, see you guys. Take care. Bye.